Welcome back, everyone. I will be trying out this Azorius Auras deck with some new updated cards from Kamigawa. This list was played by Andrzej Strzalski in the Neon Dynasty Championship, and the new cards are a Gunjo and Otawara, which aren't actually as free as it may seem. I think at least the Otawara probably belongs in the deck because it's gonna be, you know, really good, for example, in the mirror where you can bounce somebody else's really big creature already in hands with a bunch of auras. But I'm not really sure about a Gunjo if you need it. The downside is that your Glacial Fortresses come into play tapped if you only have that one a Gunjo or that one Otawara. So I'm not really sure if I would play that a Gunjo myself, but that's the list that, you know, I pulled up from the tournament, and that's the list I want to try. So I'm going to stick to it for now. The other new card is Light-Paws, which is replacing a few copies of SRAM. It is also legendary, but the thing with SRAM is it doesn't matter if you draw multiple copies because you only really need one in play. As long as you have one, you're chaining auras and you're drawing a lot of cards. So we'll see how that plays out. Light-Paws is a 2-mana 2-2. Whenever an aura enters the battlefield under your control, if you cast it, you can search for another one that costs same or less, that has a different name than each aura you control. So, I mean, that allows you to only really play one Old Eye Glitters and one Curiosity. But for example, I really liked Old Eye Glitters in this deck. I think trying to just go super aggro, or not super aggro, but just like having a card that like you slam it on something and the creature just grows so much bigger and you can usually take down someone in one or two swings means that, you know, it takes you less time to actually finish people off, which is always, you know, a good thing. And the other new cards in the list is pretty much just Esper Sentinel, which wasn't always in there. I like that it gives the deck something to play on turn one. Like, you can certainly put some auras on the Sentinel as well. But I don't know, I'm a little too worried that there aren't four SRAMs. Like, this deck works because of Core Spirit Dancer and because of SRAM. This deck doesn't work because you are slamming Curiosities on Esper Sentinel. I mean, it's okay, you can certainly win some games that way, but I would still be worried that we only have six ways to really go off. I mean, you can do it with Light-Paws, but we'll see how that plays out. One more thing I wanted to mention. Portable Hole at the sideboard looks really good for the mirrors, for example. Yeah, that's the thing with Selfless Savior. Like, it used to be great when, you know, all these Jeskai decks played only like a Lightning Helix and then like an Anger of the Gods or Wrath of God. But these days, everyone has Portable Hole, March of the Otherworldly Light, you know, Claim the Firstborn. Like, there's so many ways to exile creatures or steal them or just, you know, do something else to them other than destroy that. Selfless Savior can be great in certain matchups or just feel like you're playing a 1-mana 1-1. So that's the thing that I don't like about the recent changes with Blue-White, or how the format develops in the new cards. Like, those cards are bad for Blue-White, Portable Hole and stuff. But at the same time, a lot of people brought this deck to the championship, and that was really strange to me because I expected, you know, these kinds of cards to just keep people from playing auras, but it still was one of the most popular decks, and it performed just about 50%, but, you know, the fact that it was so popular still means that you are going to play against it on the arena ladder and you are going to run into it in tournaments. So, yeah, that's the deck, and I'll be back with some games. The Auras deck is probably even better in best of one than it is in best of three, because your sideboard isn't really all that great. Like, you have some Dovin's Vetoes, which are certainly good against control. And what is the other card? And you have Portable Hole, which is great in the mirror. But other than that, like, your cyber cards are definitely not as impactful as the cards that people are bringing in against you. This is the kind of hand that I was talking about. Like, having Otawara instead of an island is going to make this come into play tap, which is going to be a little awkward. But our hand is really good, so hopefully that's not going to really matter all that much. Blue-white. Do I just slam the obsession on it? Not really give my opponent time to start interacting. I guess if they have Portable Hole, I'm kind of screwed. I guess I'll play Light. You know what? I will go for the Curious Obsession. Like, on turn 3, they can already have Divine Purge, so I want to get some cards out of this very quickly. Here comes the Helix. Yep. I would certainly prefer drawing cards here, I think, but I can definitely make it also a 4-4, which means that they're not going to be able to kill it with another Helix. I would love to get Obsession, but it's going to fall off if I take it, so that's not going to work. I guess I'm taking No, I have Sentinel's Eyes in hand. I shouldn't be doing that. I mean, it's the only really reasonable option, so let's go with Sentinel's Eyes. Next turn, I can play one of the other auras and find Curious Obsession, or... Oh, is that Numizen? A basic mountain. I mean, they did assemble Tron on turn 3. I mean, that's gotta be Niv-Mizzet. If it's gonna be anything, it's gonna be that. Yeah, I kind of just have to go all in on this. If they had something like Vanishing Verse, this would come into play untapped, so I'm just going to be slamming auras on this guy. Here comes the Curious Obsession. And I will also find Curiosity. Yep. Draw two cards, let's go. Core Spirit Dancer, maybe. Okay. I'll keep the Staggering inside in hand just in case they have a way to deal with this. They could certainly have a card like the Fairy, they can have, you know, they can find Vanishing Verse. We'll see. Uh-oh, untapped? Okay, that's good. That's much better than Vanishing Verse. Yeah, you can get rid of my Staggering Inside. It's not a huge deal. I'll get a Lures back in my hand and kind of like prepare for, you know, a Wrath effect or something on their next turn. Yeah, attack for 7. Get myself some new cards. Okay. Comes back. This is legendary, unfortunately, so I can't really play that. Even if they play Niv-Mizzet, like, my creature is bigger. I can also just bounce the Niv-Mizzet and play Sentinel's Eyes. Yeah, like, I think this card is much more impactful. Will they find an answer? Uh-oh, this is being targeted, no? Are they just checking how much? No, they found Vanishing Verse. Yikes. Yeah, that happens. Light-Paw is number 3. So Lurus does nothing really other than bring back a Sentinel. I would rather keep Lurus in hand, I think. So let's do this. We all play the one from hands, actually, probably, but Not if I draw a Sentinel, so I think this is better still. And I just don't want to exile any of these cards because they're all good. Can exile Curiosity and Obsession, I suppose. Curiosity and Obsession. Submit. Alright, I will be back in just 1 second. I think an extra creature is always going to be good here. I guess I go for another one. But this one from hand, yep. Get an Arcane Flight. We're big enough to survive most things. One more short break. All right, we're definitely back. Maelstrom Pulse. Okay, so this is now Lura's time, I think. Lightning Elixir. So now I can start exiling the creatures. I want a... I guess Curious... I'll leave it in the deck probably. Put it on Light-Paws. Is that even good to do it here? Yeah, I need to make it a 4-4, I think. I don't want to get screwed by... Deafening Clarion, I think. So I'll make this guy into a 4-4. They can kill this, but the Sentinel's Eyes can be replayed from their graveyard, and this is going to stay alive. So unless they have something like Culling the Weak, Niv-Mizzet. Yeah, now I'm going to need to find all that glitters. This is exactly why I like the card so much, because of exactly situations like this. But I guess I'm probably going to be fine still bouncing this, unless they find Vanishing Ver... Oh, they did find... What did they find? They found actually three ways to deal with my stuff? Oh, boy. And the mana to do it. Justice Strike. Yeah. Still enough. Because if they took damage to cast it, okay, that's fine. Wow, Otawara for the win! Round one, game one brings the victory with the new card from Kamigawa. So that was kind of cool. That card definitely earned its slot just right now. And this is what I'm talking about. Like, the sideboard here, not all that relevant. I feel like I can't really bring anything in because none of these cards are really all that relevant. I guess Dovin's Veto might just be better than Spell Pierce because they end up having a lot of mana and all their cards that are relevant cost two. It's all the Vanishing Verses, Lightning Helixes, you know, cards like Justice Strike, the blue black card they end up having in hand at the end of the game. Tyrant Scorn. So maybe spell pierce is going to be great on, you know, turn three sometimes, but later on in the game they're going to have five mana, they're going to play a two mana card, and you're going to have spell pierce in hand wishing it was something else. So I'm going to put two vetoes in, and none of the other cards are actually relevant at all, so we're going to do it like this. Yep, that's the kind of hand that you have to mulligan. The one thing, if you're going to take something away from this video, is you don't keep hands that are just not good enough. Like, you need to have a creature, you need to have one of those impactful two mana creatures, and even if you're mulliganing to four, and your hand is land, you know, Core Spirit Dancer, and an aura, that's much better than starting on six and going, you know, four lands, double Selfless Savior, or like something like that. So just don't be afraid to mulligan. You're gonna get the cards back. You're gonna get them back with the triggers. Two mana 5/5. Yeah, no big deal. Just your average sized creature for two mana. I think I'm playing SRAM. I need to start going off, but I can also play. Actually, you know what? Light-Paws is better here, because the way I want to play this now is if my opponent plays. Actually, no. SRAM was better. I was thinking that, you know, I'm gonna start playing auras next turn on this. If I draw one, I'm gonna make this a lot bigger. But I also want to play SRAM, and I think I want to spread the auras on both of those creatures. And this way, I have to put everything on Light-Paws. Okay, that just solves all the problems. That's actually perfect for me because I had a second one of those, so. Can play both of them plus one of the twos. Okay, I'm gonna be playing a gun Joe. Now I'll play SRAM. Next round I'll play Light-Paws. If I draw a creature, if I draw an aura, I'll be able to start putting some auras on SRAM and some on the Light-Paws for free. There we go. There we go. Otawara. I don't have to play it right now, but if I do, then I'll have a dual left over instead of a blue land. So if I draw any kind of aura, I can still play it. I think this is the time where we play the Otawara. Playing in Znif-Mizzet is always, like, you feel like whenever you're playing Gruul, they draw four Lightning Helix. Whenever you play Auras, they draw four Vanishing Verse. Return it to hand. Okay. Well, I'm going to be drawing anyway, right? No? Oh, not yet. Okay. So, we'll just cast the SRAM. Oh, now that I think about it, maybe I should have left one of the savers to block with. I guess I can just jump with this, because I don't want to die to a Helix. Like, that's not something that I want to have happen either. So yeah, this is horrible, but I just have to jump with the savior. This is exactly why the spell pierce wouldn't really be all that great, because, like, yeah, first two turns, okay. Destroy, no. just everything. They have so many different cards for two that just completely screw you. Like all these vanishing root bounce your stuff. Like Niphas is actually probably one of the worst matchups you can play against with this deck. Yeah, I mean it gives me a creature, so I guess I'll take probably Obsession. So I can start drawing a little bit. Maybe Curiosity is better because that doesn't force me to attack next turn. But, you know what? Let's do some more damage. I would like to draw. Okay, well, that was not it. Last turn was also like a point in the game where sometimes it's better to just say, okay, well, I can't really beat much anyway, so instead of just jumping and like losing my selfless savior, I'm just gonna you know, hope that you don't have it, and I'm gonna try to win actually the game with what I have and just hope that, you know, your hand isn't great. But at the same time, if their hand wasn't great, they would be using the ability. So yeah, this is the kind of situations where they obviously don't have lands in hand, so I will be jumping. Yeah, well, we have to hope that this works out, I suppose. I mean, I could play Lurrus plus Savior and still hold this. Just hit. Yeah, I'm gonna just attack. I think they have a way to deal with it. It's just so likely right now. And like Lurrus and Savior is actually quite a good way to defend yourself. Like you have an indestructible. Yeah. Gets exiled, of course. What's better to play here? I guess Savior is better. Like if I play Cartouche, they can easily have Deafening Clarion and just sweep my board away. You really wonder how many of these things they have. Like at some point, like you can't just play all two mana removal in this format. Like at some point, you need to play other cards as well. Yeah, this is the situation where I can't beat Helix. Because if I block, make it indestructible by sacking the Savior, and they have Helix to kill this, then I'm kind of just losing anyways. Because my board's gone, all I have is this. So I'm just going to take it now. If they have a Helix, sure, then I lose. Because it's the kind of situation where like you lose anyway. Yeah, I wouldn't have been able to beat this. Regardless, so I mean, maybe if I draw exactly Core Spirit Dancer and then five running auras, but it's much better to put yourself in a position where if they don't have the Helix and their hand is, you know, Deafening Clarion and Niv-Mizzet that they don't have the fifth mana for, then you can actually just come back from this by playing Staggering Insight, and like they can't really kill it anymore because you have the Savior, you can start gaining some life back. So that was actually an interesting spot. Wonder if I bring this in, I probably do. Two mana 5/5 is a little too good. Don't really have anything to board out though. I kind of don't like the Spell Pierce. It's gotta be better on the play than on the draw, but I just really don't like that card against them. Veto's okay. Spirit Dancer, Punishment. I think I'm also used to playing 21 lands in this. I think this has an extra land. 12. That's 22. I can see boarding a Gungeon out. As weird as it sounds. Definitely want all the creatures. They have a million removal spells, and I kind of like all the auras. I don't really want to board this away or board this out. I'm just gonna board out the Aegon Joe, even though I'm on the play. It's really strange, but I think 21 lands is okay. Yep, that is not it. We can't really shuffle the deck, so if I put this on the bottom, or wait, does this shuffle it? Oh yeah, it does shuffle, okay. Unfortunately, this is the kind of hand where, like, if you play this on turn two and they have a way to deal with it, there's just nothing you can do. Keep six, yes. Probably throw away the punishment for now. Yeah, I'll just play it here. If they have a removal spell that is not Vanishing Verdure, they kind of just have to play it on their own turn, or will probably play it on their own turn, so that I don't like spell pierce them or something. That's also the reason why I don't like spell pierce, is that even in these kinds of situations where even if you had it in your hand, you'd just be like, oh yeah, next turn, like if they let me untap and go for it, then I can spell pierce. They're just not gonna wait for it. They're just gonna do it on their own turn because they don't want to run into those cards. So the best kind of spell pierce is the one that you don't have very often. Probably best here. The threat of spell pierce is just the best kind of spell pierce. They never play their cards into it, and you end up not even having it. So they kind of just play with like double sphere of resistance on their most important cards. Is it sphere of resistance? No, that's the other one. No, it is Sphere of Resistance, never mind. All spells cost an additional one to play. Opponent trying to figure out what to do. There's the Clarion. Yeah, they draw a card. Okay. I think I'm bringing back the Sentinel because that's kind of the best I can do. Hopefully, if this fails, I'll be able to find a Spirit Dancer or something to just start getting some cards back. A lot of times, just getting your creature big enough to survive card, you know, three damage is enough to deal with a lot of problems from the other deck. But this deck has so many other cards. They can bounce it to my hand, they can exile it, just destruct it, deals a million damage anyway, though it doesn't kill Spirit Dancer. Well, how about we make a 6/6? What do you say, guys? I mean, it's the best we can do, so let's go. Actually, it's gonna be a 5/5. I can't really play all of it, so I'm gonna play just one Sentinel's Eyes. Yeah, we're all in. Let's go. I could have also just played the Obsession and Arcane Flight and kept the auras in hand, but I think at this point, I'm just gonna go all in. Like, you know, attack for three with flying, they can block. Maybe I can draw into Spirit Dancer. And like, I'm just gonna hope that a million things, you know, go right. I think instead of doing that, I'm just gonna hope their hand is like another Deafening Clarion, a bunch of stuff they can't use. Yeah, never mind. Well, there's a Spirit Dancer. Okay. We can play the Sentinel's Eyes from the graveyard. So we didn't actually lose all that much. We just lost an additional cartouche. This deck is literally just all removal. It is kind of wild how this deck works. Well, they don't have any 2-mana removal, so that's good. This is also decent. And yeah, I did actually lose the Sentinel's Eyes because they did exile it from my graveyard. So that was a nice additional bonus on the Kavu. And now we just need to draw some auras. The problem with playing only these two and then passing was that it would still die to Helix or Clarion. So I guess I could have made it a 4-4 with just the Sentinel's Eye, not make it 5-5 and keep the cartouche in my hand. Oh boy, really? Ugh. That's exactly what I said about the Savior. Like, it's great in some matchups. It's great if your opponent is on, you know, Helixes and that stuff, but they have Portable Hole, Vanishing Verse, March, then you are kind of screwed. I think they just drew this also because they didn't. No. They had only one black source, never mind. Are they targeting this? Yeah. Wait, before blocker? So I can even block this with the indestructible guy now? Interesting. Oh yeah, Dovin's Veto, exactly what I wanted. I don't know how much I like the Sentinel. Like, if it's like, this is not an aggro deck. This is not some kind of like white weenie where you end up playing Talia's Lieutenant to put counters on it. Like, I would just much rather have access to 4 SRAM, 4 Spirit Dancer. And like 2 Light-Paws, and then just play like 4 Savior and maybe 2 Sentinel, just so I have like a few more extra early drops. They're still not even discarding anything from hand, so they just have 5 lands rest spells on both of these sideboard games, and we can't really just compete with that. I think I'm actually just dead now. Would need to draw like. Exactly, a way to start drawing more cards. I don't know if I even played the Sentinel's Eyes. Probably keep it for one more. They go to 8. Probably keep it for one more turn. An update is available. Nice. It's literally all removal. Holy crap. Kavu, yeah. The Kavu did make the deck a lot better. I think that card is like actively good because it's a proactive card. Like, imagine you playing against blue-white control and this is your hand. You literally can't do anything. If they have a counterspell for your Niv-Mizzet, then you're just never gonna play a relevant card for the entire game. But against creatures, like, this deck is really good. Every time I play Gruul or this, I'm just like, just don't pair me against Niv-Mizzet. I don't wanna, you know, get frustrated every turn because they have 3 removal spells they can use on my creature. One more turn, I suppose. We can still go off. I draw a Spirit Dancer into... Yeah, okay, not happening. Spirit Dancer into, like, Cartouche and, like, some lifelink thing and, like, a bunch of stuff, and I have an extra token around. Yeah, okay. All right, that was game one. I will restart arena and come back with round 2. We're back with round 2, and we have a special guest. A very special guest, in fact. Oh, gosh. As special as it gets. Cook. I don't think he likes being held like this too much. Opponent goes first. Yeah, that's a decent hand. Double Spirit Dancer. All you're looking for, okay. Are we playing the mirror? That's the question. I don't think I'm gonna be playing Spell Pierce here. Also, if you play this untapped, it is like a guaranteed thing to have a Spell Pierce in your hand. I could have played this untapped, but I think the 2 extra life could be much more relevant. Okay, I did not expect to see Mindstone of all cards. I thought I could be playing the mirror or against like some kind of humans deck where it is unlikely for me to use a spell pierce. Like if they're gonna put, you know, Curious Obsession on their Esper Sentinel, then that's okay because my core Spirit Dancers are gonna end up being bigger. So them playing Mindstone caught me completely off guard. Sigh. Oh, it's a kind of artifact deck. Interesting. Poor Devil Hole. It's funny that I started this video by talking about how Selfless Savior is not at its best at the moment, and this is exactly what's happening. We're playing against cards like Vanishing Verse, Poor Devil Hole. Hopefully this doesn't pass my turn. I'll actually hold up the Spell Pierce now. Because first of all, even if I play an aura, I'm just giving them a card. And second, like, I can see them having, you know, maybe there are some kind of combo with Bardock. Yeah, this is, I mean, they're going to still draw a card, but better than three, I guess. Okay. I will pay. And again, I will pay. All right, let's see if this is going to be good enough. Karn. That can get them another Poor Devil Hole. Wait. Wait a second. You don't have Poor Devil? Is that not how it works? Put a card you own? From exile into your hand. Wait, do I remember Karn wrong or something? Oh, this is this card. Oh, never mind. I thought it was the creator or the creator of all or whatever that name is. This has first strike, right? So I can kill this. Yeah, that's fine. Yep. I kind of want to put Lures in my hand, but at the same time, I think having Esper Sentinel in play is nice because it kind of taxes the opponent, and I think this should be in play as well. So I'll just wait with Lures. I'm using my mana in a really awkward way. Like, whenever you can make a play, it is almost always better to try to use all your mana possible. But in this situation, even though I have two unused mana, I think having Light-Paws in play is better because if I draw basically any aura, I can start going off. By putting, you know, something on this, the Light-Paws, or like two, actually both of them can just straight up go on Light-Paws and, you know, make it a big flyer and start attacking, maybe put, you know, not Curious Obsession, put Arcane Flight on it, kill Karn, you know, just start doing stuff. Reverse Engineer. These are getting a little out of hand. I think we're putting this on the Spirit Dancer and getting Arcane Flight. Damn. Yes. This was the spot where I just really wanted another Aura. But I guess this is still okay-ish. It's actually fine. Because an artifact leaving the battlefield is gonna make these smaller, so that wasn't actually all that bad for me. I'll play this again. They have Crypt in play anyway, so it's not like Lurus is going to do much here. I normally hate going, you know, zero something in videos or 1-2, or I think sometimes I even recorded an 0-3 video just to show that, you know, sometimes things just don't go your way. But I think this is a good example of like showing what can happen in Historic with this deck. Like Selfless Savior is great, but a lot of situations it doesn't save you against the new cards, and I think the format became quite hostile towards a deck like Blue White Auras. Maybe we're, you know, maybe we're a little unlucky to run into two matchups that are, you know, both playing Vanishing Verse, Tyrant Scorn, Portable Hole, and all that. But I really do feel like the format as a whole, just a lot of these decks in the format have those kinds of cards. So I don't even think you can really... say that... you know, it was something unexpected or whatever, just something you have to count on. I am dying super badly, by the way. The 13-13s can just start attacking anytime. I don't really know why these are not coming in. Like, this is basically almost like the abyss. Just have to jump block every turn. Let's see. Well, that's a good one. There's just no way, right? I can trade the light boss in. I think that's actually fine, because that keeps these like much smaller. It's kind of bad to trade it for three tokens that my opponent's just getting for free, but if it means that these are not gonna kill me, I mean, that's the best I can do. Oh no! This is in my. I thought it was in my hand already. Never mind. I can't even really win. Like, when I used to play Blood Auras, my deck usually had one, what's the card? Can't be blocked. What's the name of the card? It was like one way to... Okay, we're dead. One way to get through any kind of board stall. I don't remember the aura. It's like one blue, I think, and the creature can't be blocked, and like you scry when it connects or something like that, so that even in these kinds of situations, you would still be able to do something, especially when you have Light-Paws. Like, putting those kinds of ones off in your deck is actually quite relevant. Veto looks okay. Maybe Spell Pierce is better. Like, their cards are kind of expensive. And I don't need to have six. Six is a little too much. You also need to have like a critical amount of auras. Does the creature lose abilities? It does. So if you play this on Psy, it's actually okay because they're not going to get tokens. Yeah, like Psy basically just like stops this deck from doing anything. If my opponent's able to just do their thing and play their tokens and play their spells and make tokens, then I can have a million Spirit Dancer, and eventually they're just going to be able to deal with me with my board anyways. By either having creatures that are bigger or just, you know, putting my thing on top. I think Selfless Savior does nothing in this matchup. Creatures entering the battlefield don't cause abilities to trigger. So if they have Psy and they cast Esper Sentinel, they're not going to get a token or Thought Monitor. Maybe that's not too bad. I mean, it's not great, but like I'm kind of desperate here. I also don't really love the Sentinel. Like it just the problem that I have with Sentinel in this deck is it doesn't really like if your opponent wants to ignore it, they give you an extra card, they can just do it and it's not really going to matter all that much because the 1/1 body is kind of irrelevant. And they can just choose to ignore it. It's not like attacks that, like, you know, it makes all their spells more expensive. If they just don't have the extra mana, they're just not going to be able to do it. They can just do it. You're going to get an extra card, but that card basically just. That card just replaces the 1/1. So the first card you draw just balances out the fact that you have a 1/1 that does kind of nothing. Maybe it's just like a metagame call where the card is good against. Blue white, for example. Where even just the chip damage and the 1/1 is like good enough. But there are too many decks where I don't think that maybe this is the great choice. Opponent's waiting for their initial mulligan choice, and we have a Hushbringer. So is that enough to keep? I think this matchup is just not all that great, and I'll probably just end up keeping this. Yeah, we'll see. If they have one portable hole, then I'm kind of screwed. Put on reading the card. What is this? I'm not really screwed. I can still get lures back in my hand and play it. That's the good thing about this deck. Like sometimes even just having a 2-drop and lures as your companion means you just play the 2-drop naked on turn 2, and if it dies, you know, it dies. You just bring back lures and then go ahead and bring it back on turn 5. Will I give them a card? Probably not. That doesn't sound great. Yep, there it is. Let's see if Lurrus can get the job done. I mean, 4-3, first strike, 5-4, 6-5, then 9. That's a pretty big creature. It's gonna take me quite a while to put all of this on it without giving my opponent a million cards, but. Okay, hopefully this not is this card is not reverse engineer. Ooh, hello. Yeah, I mean, I guess that's not really all that helpful, huh? With the double sentinel. If it is reverse engineer, I'm just giving them 2 cards and a three. 3 cards now. Yeah, they're tapping stuff. It is reverse engineer. Oh no. I wonder if I should have just passed. Oh no, it's not. Nice. Okay, never mind. Never mind. They could have cracked the mindstone right away and then still have stuff. To do. So this Cures Obsession 6. So what's the best way to do it? I have to pay 4. I guess I do play this untapped just in case they have something wild that I just really want to get rid of, but I think it's unlikely that I'll be using the veto. I mean, I would use it on like Garn the Great Creator, probably. Nice, we were kind of looking for something like that. So let's put it on this. You can draw some cards. Auto pay. Attack. Yep. And next I can play all that glitters, and that is going to make this a lethal threat. So they're going to have to start jumping. Either spell bomb, make them draw three. I think I would just let Lurus die rather. Or not die, like go back in my graveyard. I can replay the aura, so that's fine. It's going to slow me down significantly, but I mean, what are you going to do? I think that's still better than giving my opponent three cards. Like three is just a little too much. And that's the thing with Esper Sentinel, even in this deck. Like, it buys them a little bit of time, but other than that, the card just doesn't really do all that much. Although, obviously, in this deck, it's much better because there is, like, some other synergies. Like, it makes, you know, all the affinity spells cheaper. You can tap it to prototype. So it does a lot of extra work in this deck, and it makes a lot of sense. But in the Blood Auras deck, I just don't really feel that way. I need to start casting spells. Like, this is not the kind of situation where you can just hold up the veto and expect to still do much. Yeah. Okay. I needed to close the game fast. Like, I can't just play one spell a turn. But obviously... The Karn is pretty good. I mean, I can also just ignore this and try to kill them. They have, what, 4 mana only? So I can just give them a bunch of cards and try to kill them right now. Arcane Flight and all that glitter should be enough. One, two, three. Because I don't think they have instant speed answers. Okay, well, then that works. That works, I suppose. So again, on the draw, do I want to do things differently? Probably not. I mean, my portable hole is decent-ish because it gets rid of some of their stuff, which they have a lot of. It also kills the token when I'm attacking. So having one in the deck is okay, but I still don't think I want the Sentinel. Will I be using my hole on it? Probably not right away. I think it's better to keep it in hand, considering I only really have one good creature, that's the Light-Paws. I think I can keep my hole for their portable hole. Yeah. Or if they have like a 2-drop creature that is, you know, doing something extraordinary, I can just get rid of that. But most likely they just play a Cold Steel Heart here or something. Okay, perfect. All part of the plan. Ooh, that is... Oh, that hurts. Get rid of this, and it's your turn. Maybe you should have brought more. Okay. We're always a turn late with everything. I think this game is done. And they just stab this. Like, it's not even really. Yeah. Yeah, I don't think. Okay, let's try. Flying. Okay, so I can do this cartouche. Take this hit, because there's a pretty good chance this keeps growing on my opponent's future turns, and in that case I would rather chump block a bigger attack. Five mana up or more, thanks to the prototypes. Do they have another one? We'll see. Okay, we're gonna be drawing some cards. Maybe there is still a chance after all. Is keeping up spell pierce even good now? Costs me 2 mana to do it, but I guess I don't really have much else to do anyways. If I play the all that glitters, I don't even think that's all that great, so. What do I want to put in their hand? Probably Karn. Probably the Archive. At least it's expensive. They want to use it to draw too. It's going to cost them a bunch of mana, so that's okay. Yep. Not today, no. 14, I go to 5, I get 4 back, maybe more, because I have all that glitters. It's probably still okay to not chump, but at the same time, I don't really want to risk them like playing a bunch of poor devil holes next turn and me then not having a blocker. So if I chump now, I think it is fine to chump. How many auras does this have? Is there a way to three? And this has how many? Three, that's six, seven, eight. Actually, you know what? I'm not blocking. I do need to put as on a lifelink creature. I need to make sure that happens. Staggering inside. It only puts the aura on it though, right? On the battlefield to light pause, yeah. So staggering inside makes this lifelink as well. Now I'm just gonna be attacking them because they're just dying now. Oh, this should attack because they have to chump one of these two creatures. This was a missed point of damage. Well, we have double spell pierce up. Hopefully that's gonna be good enough. Okay, gonna need to have a little bit more than that. I'll give them the expensive card because I don't think there's gonna be time for that to still make any real impact in this game. Wow, I think they just flooded out completely, or I don't really know what it was in their hand, but whew. Harshbringer, even a turn too late, still was good enough. Yeah, so blue-eyed auras, there you have it. The light pause, I definitely think that card is good. I don't know if you should be playing two or three copies. There were definitely times where we drew two, and it felt kind of awkward. And maybe Sram would have been better. I'm not really sure which one should be a three of, but I do like playing some number of those. I think that card is definitely good. What I didn't like was the Esper Sentinel. I think that card is just not really all that great. It's good in human decks, you know, it works better, it creates the extra pressure, like every damage counts. It works well with Talia's Lieutenant. Those kinds of decks usually play cards like Collected Company, they're really good at finding Lieutenant. It adds some extra value to the artifact deck because you can tap it to prototype, it makes everything cost less mana with affinity for artifacts, so makes a lot of sense in those kinds of decks. Here it is just kind of like a tax permanent for the opponent that they can just ignore if they want to. So I don't know. I'm not a fan, but maybe that's just me. It also just has no impact if you draw it later in the game. Like a draw, an Esper Sentinel draw on turn four just doesn't do anything. So if it was me, I would play the deck a little bit differently. But you can choose, you know, many different versions. I think Jim Davis also played Auras. He finished first after Swiss. I don't think he even lost the match, but most of those wins, I think, came in Alchemy, and I believe he was 5-0 in Historic with his take on blue-white, so you can take a look at that as well, you know, just play whatever version you like the best, and the core is obviously keeps, remains the same, like it's the Spirit Dancer kind of stuff that really makes this deck so powerful, so it, regardless of what's the rest, just make sure you mulligan hands that don't really have anything to put your auras on because that's just not worth it. So yeah, as always, thanks to Channel Fireball Marketplace for sponsoring the video, channelfireball.com where you find all the deck guides, and OnTapGG for letting us see all the recent metagame trends and all the deck lists and everything. Thank you and see you next time.